The information superhighway to who knows where. It's 30 years since Scott Walker first arrived in Britain from California. Within months, he and the Walker brothers were the biggest teen idols in the country, the Take That of their day, with hits like The Sun Ain't Gonna Shine Anymore. In the late 60s, Scott Walker went solo, creating a uniquely European sound, with songs like Jacques Brel's Jackie, which helped him to acquire a cult following. He hasn't played live since 1978, and his last interview was in 1984. Yet he has continued to be the subject of public fascination, so much so that the Sunday People once launched a national search for Walker, the most beautiful voice of his time. Now he's emerged very much into view again with the critically acclaimed album Tilt, a mature collection of songs featuring lyrics about arms dealing, the Holocaust and religion. Tonight, with the help of Scott Walker himself, we trace the journey from light entertainment to the dark musing of arguably the most enigmatic figure in pop.
This night you are mistaken. I'm a farmer in the city, dark farmhouses against the sky. Every night I must wonder why. Harness on the left nail keeps wrinkling. Then higher above me is you. Can't go by a man from Rio.
I don't think there are that many figures in pop music that Scott Walker compares to. He changed the way people think pop music can be and how it can operate, and he's not been afraid to look outside pop to the world of classical music and jazz, even the world of cabaret and the world of film soundtracks. He said you can put all these things into pop music. Pop music doesn't have to be a four-piece beat combo singing songs of boy meets girl. That's not what Scott Walker is about. So I think he's kind of expanded the vocabulary of the popular song.
I had a green light for 50,000. It was the month of July. We had more in our go-down. You were responsible for the rolling stock.
You get the feeling that he's got something in his head that comes out on records in a way that is really hard to trace back to other people. That's one reason why he's so difficult. It's very difficult for people to find a line to earth with what he does. And there's something really quite alien about the way he puts different things together. I think he crossed the border between his original work, the Walker Brothers' work, and what he's done now. I mean, the distance is so far.
Always.
you have to say that really there are two quite separate Scott Walkers to talk about in artistic terms, if you like. The first is the one that most people, I suppose, would remember from the 60s as the lead voice of the Walker Brothers, behind the big hits that they had in the UK at the time, like Make It Easy on Yourself and The Sun Ain't Gonna Shine Anymore. And that was really a classic middle-of-the-road pop of its period. And he appeared to continue to follow in that sequence when he went out as a solo act by making a series of records, which in terms of the sound of them, well, there was considerable similarities.
And his voice cracks from the morning.
But if you listened simply beyond that surface thing, you quickly realize it was quite different, which brings us on to the other Scott Walker, who is the songwriter and the great artist, if you like. And through those initial solo albums, the subject matter grew increasingly, well, out of kilter with certainly what his original audience would have expected.
I wanted to ask about a record that you made on, I can't remember what album, Plastic Palace People. Do you remember that?
Plastic Palace People.
I'm sorry, I can't hear.
Hello, can you hear me better?
Yes, I can hear you now.
Oh, good. What did you want to know about it?
Well, I wanted to know what the words meant, because I didn't like them. They unnerved me.
It unnerved you, yeah.
I remember that one, but I believe you wrote it.
Yeah.
Well, what did they mean?
Yes, well, to go into that now is, it would be too long and too heavy right now, but I can see why it unnerved you. It unnerved me at the time writing it. Okay?
Does it mean what it sounds as though it means?
Yeah.
Plastic palace people, through fields of clay and granite gray, they play without a sound. Plastic Palace Alice blows gaping holes to store her fears inside her lover's head. Listen.
When Scott Walker was a pop star, I wasn't aware of him. And I know that he did a TV program, which I find hard to imagine. And I think that adds to this kind of schizophrenic thing, that on one hand, he was doing these very kind of dark records, and then he was some kind of light entertainment figure as well, presenting a program on telly. I mean, it's kind of like if you imagine if Des O'Connor did an album of Bertolt Brecht songs or something, you know, you wouldn't really believe it, would you? And so I think it must have been very hard, if you were a fan of his, to really know exactly what he was on about, you know.
My hands stopped shaking. You remember all the pain that come back to me. You want to beat her black and blue, but don't you do it, I beg you.
He was terribly influenced by Jacques Brel even then. Most people had never heard of Jacques Brel. He loved Michel Legrand. He was a very romantic, lush film composer, in fact. He did film scores mainly. So he was much more European looking than anybody else at that period.
Je veux qu'on rit, je veux qu'on danse, je veux qu'on s'amuse comme des fous, je veux qu'on rit, je veux qu'on danse, quand c'est qu'on me mettra dans le trou. Adieu l'Antoine, je t'aimais pas bien. Adieu l'Antoine, je t'aimais pas bien, tu sais, j'en crève de crever aujourd'hui, alors que toi, t'es bien vivant et même plus solide que l'ennui. Adieu Antoine, je vais mourir. C'est dur de mourir au printemps, tu sais, mais je pars aux fleurs.
Seeing a German girl at the time, and she was a friend and had a habit of drinking quite a lot of Pernod, you know, but she kept this Pernod under the bed. I remember all this, and she would play Brel records into the night, and I just loved them. One day I went to see Andrew Oldham, who was managing the Stones at that time. We were just friends at the stage, and just for a visit. And I mentioned him, and he said, "Yeah," he said, "it's funny you should mention that because I've got some translations come over from the States," and he played some rough demo records of these translations. And I said, they were in English, of course, translations. And I said, "Well, that's great. Can I do them? Is it possible?" And he said, "Sure, I don't see why nobody else is doing them." This was before the Jacques Brel Alive and Well show and all that sort of thing went on. So I immediately took them, and within a week, I set up a session to cover them. I knew that was the lock for my first album to unlock. You know, that was a key. And that really unlocked my whole imagination thing.
Boys, come back to hell. Matilda's come back to me. Charlie, champagne right away. I know you've been saving it for a holiday, but Matilda's come back to me.
It's quite common in rock music and pop music for English or British or even European artists to sort of ape the mannerisms and culture of American rock. Scott Walker's perhaps a unique example of someone who's gone completely the other way. He is American, but his concerns as an artist seem to have always looked towards Europe. He's got European sensibilities, and those four solo albums show that. And I think that's what's striking about him. He's someone who's turned away from his own culture that I think he's always seen as quite frothy and materialistic and not very deep, and has always had this, there's a sort of darkness about those solo records that's very European, I think. And I think that's what makes them striking, particularly from someone who'd come from a sort of US pop tradition.
The thing that drove me here, apart from the army chasing me, because that drives you out pretty quickly too, but it was the combination of things. And I don't know why. I was a kid in Southern California who had a very early age just loved watching Lola Montez and films like that, you know. And I used to watch this movie, The Rocking Horse Winter, and I've never seen it on television here. It was an English film, and I was just fascinated. I was very young when I must have seen this, and it had the boy in it who was in Oliver Twist, the young boy was in Oliver Twist, and they had such a dreamlike quality which the American things didn't have for me. And then I developed a European imagination, which probably has nothing to do with Europe at all. People say that my records have more of a European sound than Europeans get on their records. And it's only because I've developed this, I think, this European I imagine it better for them in some ways.
All the losers I don't.
I've been writing the same stuff since 1968, 69, just paring it down. It's hard to think of the form I write in. It's hard to think of exactly what it is. There are a lot of songwriters that say that their stuff is poetry, and then they add music to it. I'm not so sure. I never define one or the other. Things are blurred these days, you know, and I don't think of it that way. I mean, I do the words first. All of my stuff is word-driven. Everything comes from the lyric. So the lyric's very important to me, that's why I take so much time over it, but I'm not sure it's poetry, really.
Cripple fingers, hit limousine, yes. Shall that come?
Columbine. Some have flags. Crippled fingers hit the rounds of shell.
I think if you listen through Tilt in particular, more than ever before, he's broken down song structure to the point where some of them are almost like meditations on the song form, rather than being songs, or narratives, or they're about songs, rather than being songs themselves. Sometimes I think he almost doesn't want to do music, which seems a bizarre thing to say, but you get the feeling that almost he's concerned with the conceptualizing of it, the idea of it. I wonder how this would sound if we did this, and you feel you're almost eavesdropping on somebody's workshop, and you know, as finished as the record is, and it does feel very final. At the same time, it feels almost like something caught in progress.
I string along. A string of love. Whoa, whoa, whoa.
In all of my songs, there's a character struggling away, you know. So I just try to think of what would pertain to this character and all the images that would go into how he's feeling. And it's the character I am, perhaps, in all these different guises, you know.
We can save it, we can change it, and put it in lines across the room, but we'll never stop it bristling. And I gotta quit.
Scott Walker. Mark Lawson will be back tomorrow night with Late Review, but we leave you tonight with a selection from the World Press Foundation's annual exhibition, opening tomorrow at the National Theatre in London, of some of the most striking images from the news pages in the last year. Good night.
Rob, who once rivaled the Beatles for popularity. He and his group, the Walker Brothers, were responsible for such massive hits as The Sun Ain't Gonna Shine Anymore. His modern-day fans include the likes of David Bowie, Jarvis Cocker and Alison Goldfrapp. But if his music and his name are still well known, his face certainly isn't, because Scott Walker also happens to be one of pop music's most determined recluses. It's been more than 10 years since he released an album or gave a television interview. But now, with a new record on the way, Verity Sharp got to meet him.
I'm good at solitary, you know, I always have been. I can spend lots of time on my own, I'm fine.
The brilliant yet enigmatic Scott Walker is probably best known as the good-looking frontman of the Walker Brothers, the band that arrived in Britain from California in 1965, causing a huge sensation with number one hits like Make It Easy on Yourself and The Sun Ain't Gonna Shine Anymore.
My particular being, I guess, took over and I separated off.
At the height of his fame, when he had it all, the looks, the voice, the stardom, Walker chose simply to walk away, to pursue instead the uncompromising music that he believed in, whatever the cost.
21. He took music to a place that it hasn't actually ever been since.
You can't really think that a human being can create such fantastic music. You know?
Walker's music has remained underground, yet his maverick genius has inspired generations of pop artists. His influence borne out by the number of musicians who've signed up to celebrate the man in a forthcoming documentary. I have a green light
for 50,000. It was definitely painting pictures within your mind, but not in a kind of cliched way.
This is proper music. And it was really beautiful. I was just totally captivated by it.
You have a kind of a reputation, a notoriety, really, for being a very private person, if not quite a reclusive person. Have you become more reclusive, or are you just naturally like that, or did you have to sort of remove yourself from people?
Well, I mean, a friend of mine says, I'm not a recluse, I'm low-key, you know, and that is the best way to put it. I mean, it's like people who say, you know, I'm not insane. They probably are insane, but I'm not a recluse, you know. Mm.
So when people sort of say, well, we haven't seen anything of Scott Walker for the last 10 years, you know, you haven't consciously been trying to avoid people.
No, well, some people, but no, generally, if I've got nothing to say or do, you know, it's pointless to be around, I think. Loneliness is a cloak
you wear, a deep shade. So how comfortable were you back in the 60s when it was all, you know, you were kind of as famous as the Beatles, weren't you, back then, with the Walker Brothers? Mm. Did you feel completely, you know, out of character?
At first it was fine. You know, I mean, I hate, you know, people in the business who bitch about, you know, the business. It's such an awful life. At first, it was fantastic for the first couple of albums or so. But then it really wears you down. In those days, it was particularly, I mean, today it would probably be a lot better. But touring in those days was very primitive, you know, and it was really a lot of hard work. And you couldn't find anything good to eat anywhere, you know. I mean, the hours were unbelievable. You'd end up with terrible curries and stuff on the road, you know, and it was really difficult. And make
it easy. The brothers shocked the world when they split in 67, and Walker's subsequent disappearance fueled rumors of his whereabouts and of a mental breakdown.
I don't know if this is myth, this story that when you wanted to get out, you completely ran, really, and you went away to a monastery. Is this true?
Yes, but not for that reason. I went to learn Gregorian chant.
Did you really?
Yes, yeah.
Oh, yeah, very see, nice. Yeah, you dispel that rumor. My hands stop shaking. You remember all the pain that's come back to me.
Walker remained disillusioned with the music industry until he stumbled across the music of French singer Jacques Brel, who inspired him to embark on a solo career.
I met a girl who was working in the Playboy Club, and yeah, I know you. and it's a German girl, and we were back at her place one night, and drinking quite a lot, and she said, "Oh, you got to hear this guy," and she put him on. Adieu, Antoine, je t'aimais pas bien. Adieu, Antoine. I was so excited. Then I wanted to bring this to people. I was so excited about what I found. And it was, you know, it was great being in the studio and being able to do that. And if one day I should become a singer with a Spanish
bum who sings for women of great virtue. Walker's first solo albums included much of Brel's work, but gradually he began experimenting with his own compositions, using different rhythms and styles. Drifting away from his record-buying public, his later albums were commercial failures, and Walker's time at the top was over.
The problem really started with my third album, because my third album was practically the whole thing written in 3/4. I mean, ridiculous, you know, to write a whole album in 3/4. You know, you can't dance to it so easily, you know, unless you wanted to waltz all night. You know, it's like, and I think, you know, before I'd given something that people could hang on to, you know, but then it kind of drifted away. I became kind of a leper. I mean, people didn't really want to touch me after, you know, commercially, after the albums I started to make. And after that, I don't know what happened. A whole lot of drinking, you know, that kind of stuff, you know.
Walker totally disappeared from public view, only resurfacing as a solo artist with the album Climate of the Hunter in 1984, and then over a decade later with the very experimental album Tilt.
People say that your music is very different now and much harder now, but actually, do you feel like you're doing the same?
It is a lot harder now. It's very shaved down, but I think the mood is probably the same. I mean, the mood is, you know, the mood is shaved down as well, but it's probably, if you go back there, you can find whoever that young guy was in the woodwork, you know.
But it's a long way from the easy pop ballads of the brothers. Walker's new work is complex and challenging, yet it has still attained legendary status amongst his peers in the music industry.
Scott Walker is a real serious artist, a very conscious artist, as someone who really thought about the medium that he was working in and thought, how could I take this apart? What can I do in this medium that you can't do in any other way? No needle
through glass. It's like an intrepid explorer or something, you know, it's somebody who goes to a part of the world that nobody's ever been to before. You have to admire somebody who is so single-minded.
Maybe there's a sense that it's like music for musicians rather than music for punters, you know.
Well, I don't know. I hope not. I mean, there's a lot of people writing songs that are accessible. So, I mean, you know, there's a lot of that kind of music out there. I think I hope anyway that if you work at it, you know, you'll connect with it on some level.
Walker's latest album, The Drift, took 7 years to make. It follows the same avant-garde path and includes some very radical percussion techniques.
It's got to sound almost like a sheet of metal. You know, it's just a wee bit musical.
Yeah, okay.
Your music's kind of becoming sparser and sparser.
Yeah, it is.
So is The Drift, you know, even more bare?
Yes, it is. It's really shaved down, and in fact, there's no arrangements per se on it. You know, I mean, years ago, I used to have and use a lot of glorious arrangements. You know, but now it's big blocks of sound. I mean, the orchestra's there, but it's noises and big blocks of sound, and it's even come down to that. Jesse, are you listening?
Walker hasn't toured since the 70s, and The Drift is only his third solo album in over 30 years.
You obviously do work slowly.
Yeah.
I mean, you prefer to work slowly.
Yeah, yeah.
To let it come to you rather than...
That's right. If you force it, it always shows. It always shows when it's the filler. You know, you're filling your stuff up and you simply got to be patient.
Yeah. And is your head already busy on the next thing?
Well, I've already got ideas for the next thing, and I'm hoping I can move on, you know, because I can't listen to this anymore, you know, it's...
Mm. Yeah. Will it be another 10 years?
No, I hope not, no. Be alive by then. Oh. Probably not.
Scott Walker talking to Verity Sharp, and his new album, The Drift, is out in May. It's probably worth catching. Let's face it, you might have to wait another 10 years for the next one.
For Jan Morris. She's one of the most popular and best-selling travel writers in the world, and has converted her own adventures and experience into nearly 50 books. Her personal journey has been equally extraordinary. While crossing continents, she also crossed the gender divide. Now, in her 80th year, Morris has written a despairing vision of the modern city. But this time, it's a fictional city, one that she's christened Have. For the Culture Show, Madeleine Holt travelled to North Wales to visit Jan Morris and found the writer's natural optimism replaced by something much darker.
List the works by Jan Morris and they read like an index from an atlas. Venice, Manhattan, Oman, Sydney, Hong Kong, Spain, Canada. In a lifetime of voyaging, she's taken readers to quaint outposts, forgotten cities, fading civilizations.
Mostly, they're books about place, you know, really. And not even that, they're books about one person's responses to place. If you see what I mean, I don't pretend they're true. I don't pretend if somebody else goes to a place that I've been to, they're going to see the same as I see it. They won't at all, I'm sure. They're purely idiosyncratic, really, sort of essays about places that I happen to have been to. She was never loved. She was always the outsider, always envied, always suspected, always feared. She fitted into no convenient category of nations. She was the lion who walked by herself. Venice was never embraced by the nations. She was like a griffin or a phoenix on the outside of a rookery.
Jan Morris's own journey has been as epic as many of the places she writes about. Because Jan was born James, she lived the first half of her life as a man. There was public school, the army, a marriage and five children. And in 1953, making a name as the only journalist to accompany Edmund Hillary on the conquest of Everest. Then in 1972, and by now an established writer, James went to Casablanca to become Jan. That experience became a pioneering autobiography. At the same time, she crossed another boundary still with an experimental piece of historical writing, her trilogy about the British Empire. In Morris's latest work, she returns to a city she invented 20 years ago in her first and only novel. It's a place called Havre.
On the whole, it was a happy city, you know. It was a mixture of peoples of all sorts. And it was based upon an old tradition, that mixed up world of, which was based really, in a way, on Europe before the First World War. I'm greatly influenced by the Habsburg Empire, and that, all that sort of misty, transcendental sort of view of the world and of Europe in particular was paramount in my mind, even if I wasn't thinking it. I thought of it as an allegory, although everybody else thought of it as a travel book. A lot of people thought it was a real place, you know. I had lots of letters asking me if they needed a visa to get there. Were it not for the vessels in the harbour, the train twice a week, and the vapour trails of the airliners flying high overhead, it would often feel as though the place occupied its own entirely separate plane of existence, insulated against everywhere else. Who cares, one soon comes to feel.
But Morris's original tale about the city ends with a mysterious catastrophe.
As it went along, in a sort of, I now think was a kind of prophetic flash, I had the place destroyed by some unknown enemy. Much in the way that the World Trade Center was destroyed in the beginning of the next century.
Now, in a new edition of the book, Morris revisits Havre after the calamity.
What was it that made you return to Havre?
Along came 9/11 and all that, and I realized that the world really was changing. It was another world now, and I thought, well, what's happened to old Havre? I better go back and have a look at it. And so I did. The new Havre is a very glittery place and a very steely place. And it is heavily influenced by both capitalism and older ideologies.
And if you had to come up with a place that it's inspired by, what would that be?
Well, it's a mixture, like the other one was, of influences upon my mind. But certainly it's more like one of these brand new cities, you know, especially a place like Dubai, for example, which has sprung out of the desert. It's very brilliant, isn't it? It's a astonishing spectacle, Dubai. People sneer and laugh at it, but it's one of the most interesting historical spectacles we're ever likely to come across. And that is, Harvey's very like that in a way, or like one of the ones further east, like Singapore or Shanghai rather than Hong Kong, places which have suddenly sprung into eminence with a distinct ideology that runs them. It's intended to be kind of glimpses of things that are happening around this particular imaginary city, which can stand in many ways for us, I suppose. It was like one of those cities of the future one used to see at world fairs or in architectural journals. Touches here and there of postmodernism, here a pinnacle, there a squirrel, only emphasised the intense functional feeling of everything. And I looked in vain for some familiar street pattern, the echo of a bazaar, the remnant of a park. Now, it seemed to me, I was looking at a cityscape machine-made, computer-calculated, absolute.
The bleakness in Morris's latest work reflects the change in the way she now sees the world.
You've spoken in the past about being a sort of natural optimist, but at the same time, you know, your most recent writing has been talking about these feelings of tension, uncertainty, dark climax. If you had to put your cards on the table and say, do I feel now more or less optimistic about the world, what would you say?
Oh, I'd say I felt less optimistic about the world, I'm quite sure. Oddly enough, my own heyday was in a particularly happy period of world history, I myself think. There were, of course, huge black patches in the world, communism, that Cold War, all that poverty and everything. But nevertheless, there was a feeling of hope. There was a sort of Victorian feeling that progress was going to be made if it wasn't actually being made now. And I shared that. I lived in a very happy period of history, I think, and I myself had a wonderfully happy time of it. And so I was naturally optimistic. But I have to say that it was 9/11 that really changed my views. And I saw a quotation from me the other day. I don't often see that, but it was in a paper somewhere. It said that I had said, all my life I've sneered at the old stiffs and farts who say the world is going to the dogs. Now at last I have a feeling they may be right. And so I do, really. I hate to say it, but I don't. It seems to be moving, swirling so fast towards some sort of a climax, which I don't understand, of course. I don't understand anything. But that I don't see how we reverse ourselves from it, really.
And now for something completely different. Are you having a party? Because they are the number one.